dog take Santa Fe. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here.
Yes.
Amen.
CJ is part of House of Prayer. We love this man. He's full of power and has the Spirit of the Lord living within him, and he is going to give you some word. Amen.
Amen.
Did everybody come to praise God tonight?
Yeah.
So all week long I was praying and asking God what he wanted me to talk about, and I kept battling and praying and praying, and tonight he laid on my heart forgiveness, because to be forgiven, you got to be able to forgive. To inherit the kingdom of heaven, you got to be able to look at your brother that may have wronged you, or your sister that may have wronged you, and say, you know what, I forgive them. No matter how mad they made me, guess what, I still love them. Because guess what, I'm forgiven, so I gotta forgive. So I got Ephesians 4, 31 and 32. It said, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you. See, when you want to lash out, and you want to say something dumb, and you want to say something mean, you got to remember that God wants you to uplift, not tear down. God wants you to build up, not ruin. See, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but God comes to build up, and he wants you to help build up his kingdom.
Well, I thank everyone for coming. Glad to see you. Thank you.
The youth camp. The rest of them are not here tonight. Amen. And so I just got to give a testimony really quick. I don't know if this is supposed to happen, but I got in the car today and I picked them up. She goes, Dre, can I play a song? And this is what happens to our young youth. They start they've been coming to church since day one, since they got here after camp. And after they got here at camp, they started learning our songs. She gets in the car today and she says, Dre, can I play a song? And it's this one. And she's like, I look at her and she's like, I get to see her face. I just want to thank you. It wouldn't have happened with all your guys' support, without all your guys' support. And because of that, we gave them some Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's tell you about our Jesus. Amen?
That's right.
While you pass upon your fears, is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to give? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? The chains and arms healing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way.
Empty grave, ain't no sinner that he can't save.
would care that much about me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh, he makes a way when there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sin that he can't stand. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is great. Now the truth is, I know him. Good for you, know what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
OBGYN. And if anybody knows anything about medical, they don't like to go out of network. They absolutely hate it. They want to keep you in their network. Well, they sent me out of network to the hospital after they did a biopsy, and it came back as grade one, which means that's what they give you the number before surgery. Stage one is after, or stage two, stage three, whatever, is after surgery. So, as the saying goes, after I stopped crying, put on my big girl pants and say, okay, now what do we do? And the doctor said, if I was to have this, I want this other doctor to operate. And this is the OBGYN telling me, this is the doctor she would ask me to go take my insurance. That's another at a network. He took my insurance.
Praise God.
Praise God.
I was in the hospital one day. I was grade one, stage one. They robotically operated on me. One night in the hospital when I came home. And God directed. God had his hand in all of it. Sometimes when we're going through things, we're thinking about God, but we're thinking about ourselves. Mm-hmm. And you know, somebody prayed for me one time before I started all this. And they said, I'm going to pray all this is taken away from you. I said, no, don't pray that. Because somebody else that I might have an acquaintance might be going through cancer. And I can't say I know how you're feeling because I've never walked in your shoes. Well, I could say I walked in those shoes. And this is what I did. This is how I did it. This is, you know, this is my experience with all this. And sometimes, well, just like Job, God didn't take all that away from Job. He had to walk in those shoes. And I walked in those shoes. And thank God, like I said, tomorrow on the 14th. In fact, it was funny to me, and I said, I was supposed to have surgery August 1st. They called me on the 12th of July. We were just started camp, kids camp. We'd spent the first night there. I was at the store getting stuff. We were having Super Nachos that night, so we had all the stuff to go with it. And they called me, and it's like, oh my goodness, because you know when you have surgery, you have to do this, and do this, and do this, and then of course, you have to have the dreaded COVID test. And it's like, okay, so I went back, and then I kind of fell apart. I said, okay, this is what's going on. I'm going to have to leave. This is the stuff for dinner, and I asked for prayer, and the ladies prayed for me, and then the gentlemen that were there prayed for me. And so we beat home, what we were holding in Delhiya, McConnell. And if anybody's had that dreaded COVID test, you know, they feel like you're tickling your brain.
Yeah.
okay? We've all had that. And so I had to have the chest x-ray, the blood work, I did all that. I was going into Walgreens to get the COVID test and the phone rings. And it was the hospital saying, well, you can have the test up here the day before. I don't know who this guy is, but I told the guy afterwards, I said, boy, if I ever have to have a COVID test again, I'm coming back to you. Because it didn't tickle my brain, it didn't hurt. Other normal. But what I said that to say this, you're never alone with God. Whether you realize it or not, He's always there for you and your family. And after I had all my surgery and I came home, I said in the recliner, because I can't do anything, it was me and the Chihuahua. He was my recovery buddy. So when John's like, are you okay, honey? Are you, can I do this? Can I do this for you? I was like, no, I'm fine. And after I was able to get up, I had a walker. It's like, I don't feel like I'm old enough for a walker. But I named my walker Gladys, so me and Gladys could get around the house, so I could go potty and go get myself something to drink, so he wouldn't have to cater to me all the time. But God is good. He is great. He is greater than we even think about. And I was not supposed to be talking and preaching, but that's my
testimony. Pastor Chris, you have a speakers that are going to come and share. I do. I believe next is Pastor Eli.
Yeah.
Right. Wow. Wow. Bye, Christian.
Thank you for inviting me to the glory of God, all the glory and honor. I'm a vessel for Him on just His hands and feet. Okay, thank you for inviting me here. You know, I never want to boast about anything but Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You know, we are the hands and feet of Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Christ is your Lord and Savior. Let me open up in a word of prayer, please. Heavenly Father, we just praise you, Lord, for your faithfulness, for sparing us, for saving us.
Thank you, Lord.
You know, the adversary, the devil, the local, whatever you want to call him, whatever he is to you, people. And the Bible, John 10:10, the adversary. His whole purpose is to kill and destroy. But Jesus Christ came down on the cross so that we can have life and have it more abundant.
Yes.
As long as we keep our eyes upon Him. We ask for your blessings upon the servant, the Lord, the fellowship, that you would receive all the glory and honor. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I'm going to talk a little bit about Christian action. Christians in action. Sometimes you get stagnant a little bit, you know, I have at least, and I need to remember that God spared me, spared you, saved you, we all have a testimony to share of God's goodness. I'm going to kind of read a few things. Christian action categorizes a Christ-centered life. It's an action that flows from your own personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And it bears witness in whatever you say, whatever you do, whatever you see. Sometimes we kind of get off track a little bit, you know. But anyway, being a Christian, we are responsible for bringing the good news. In Acts 1:8, it reads, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem, in Judea and Samaria, until the ends of the earth." Christian in action means representing Christ and His church in works, in compassion, and in love. Sometimes our love's not there, you know. Sometimes, like the brother was saying, you know, forgiveness. It's kind of hard, you know, battling that a few weeks back. You know, battling. And I won't go into details, but the Lord freed me of that last weekend. You know, just that's how it is. You know, we got to watch out for the enemy. He's out there. He doesn't sleep. That's why we have to have our shield, our body armor, our stomach, our helmet, our gloves, our everything that we have. Ephesians, up to love, put on the whole armor of God.
Yep.
You know, sometimes we take it off. I mean, sometimes I used to take mine off, but now the verse says, keep it on.
Okay.
Keep it on. Don't never take it off. You might have to adjust it. If you gain weight, you might adjust it. If you gain it back, come on. Praise, that's what it says. Keep it on. The adversary is out there to throw darts and do whatever he can use. He'll use whatever he can use to get you off track.
Yep. That's true.
Christian action means representing Christ. Why we said that? Okay, Christian action carries on Christ's work of reconciliation to the world, according to the gifts that he has given each and every one of you. Christian action makes Christ and his love real to the world. But that's only through you.
No.
We always have to let our light shine.
Amen.
Amen. In 2 Corinthians 5, 18 through 20, all this is from God, who thought for through Christ reconciliation to you and gave his ministry of reconciliation. This is Christ. God was reconciling the world to himself by counting their transgressions not against them, and entrusting us for the message of reconciliation to God. That's us. We're the messengers to our own area of influence, whether it be your home, your church, your wherever you associate with, work, wherever you may go. Christian action is how we give our hands and feet. We are the hands and feet of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
We are his body. He went to the cross to spare his life for us. And that's only way people are going to know who he is through us. We need to be always active, always. And that's why he spared us and that's why he saved us. For his glory to be used. Amen. Okay, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. It's the only way. The only way we get to heaven is through him.
Right.
It's so simple.
Right.
And some people can't believe it, how simple it is to be able to just say those words. Repent, have forgiveness, know that he died on the cross. The Bible says, you shall be saved. Yeah. You know, I'm going to talk about grace. But anyway. Okay. I want to share this quote with you from St. Teresa. Says Christ has no body that I'm sharing. Christ has no body but yours. No hands or feet on this earth but yours. Yours are the eyes through which it looks to show compassion to the world. Yours are the feet with which he walks in goodness and walks good and always observing, ready to give account. Christian action. The natural response to God's grace. God's gift of grace. It's free. The gift is free. Once you acknowledge Christ as your Lord and Savior, he gives you grace. Sometimes, I feel like sometimes when you think of grace, well, for me, when I think of grace, I think, you know, I don't deserve it. I don't deserve it. Sometimes I don't live it out. You know. Sometimes I might eat something or say something by accident or whatever. But you know, there's the grace. You know, God covers, Christ covers the multitude of sin, you know.
Amen.
I never want to take that for granted. Because I don't want to ever take it for granted. He has given us the Holy Spirit to help us, to direct us, to guide us, to show us. We always have to be aware of that. Call upon him. He's there. He'll listen. He's your advocate. We're going out to be out there to help you out. Take care of you. Meet all your needs. See, Paul makes it aware. Paul also makes us aware that the spiritual gifts are given to us for ministry. Each of us respond uniquely according to our own gifts. We all have a different gift, a special gift, part of the body of Christ. We all know that. Amen. Remember that. Yeah. You might be able to plant a seed, just, you know, share Christ with somebody.
Right.
You know, another person might want to water it, but it might not grow. It might not be you. It might be somebody else. Sometimes one waters and he gives the increase.
Mm-hmm.
But those of us that ride, you know, when we go to these events where the club, you know, other clubs go, the hardcore clubs, we're there showing up to break the ground.
Come on, man.
We're there to break the ground. Some of us will plant the seed. Some will water. It'll just be available. It's not only the club race. Wherever you go, whatever you do, be aware, be spirit led. Every day, pray that God will show you. Pray that God will. When I go out there, I would say, Lord, it's not me, it's you. You make a way for me to be able to share Christ. Whatever, a smile, whatever it might be. You know, $2, or, you know, if I give somebody a $2 that I see out there, if I meet me, then I say, I'll give you a couple dollars, but can I pray for you?
Right.
I went to, when we went to Sturgis a few years back, we were on the main track, like they're just handing out track and praying for people. This one Indian fella was on the bench. He sat by her, thought they'd just sit by me and my wife. I'm looking at him and his whole hand, he was like burning, he got that butter knife and burning himself because he thought that he wasn't worthy. And I was looking at that, but if the scars were there, and I asked him, what was that? He showed me. And I made a mistake. You know, my daughter doesn't want anything to do with me. My friend doesn't want anything to do with me. And I'm unworthy for whatever he did. He had been drinking. He smelled like alcohol. But he said, can you spare a dollar or two? I said, sure, you know, I'll give you, you know, a couple dollars. But before I do that, well, when I did it, can I pray for you? He said, pray for me. Yeah, I want to pray for you. So I prayed for him. Before you know it, after he finished, he stopped and said, you know what? You took my high away. So he said, it
wasn't. Praise Jesus!
Yeah.
So he kind of got upset a little bit, but hey, that's just the power. That's the power of God.
Glory to God.
You know, I said, all you have to do is say, Mother Earth, and say, okay, that's fine. But you could pray. You could pray and ask God to show you that. Yeah,
he was
a little
sorry,
but that's just the way it goes.
Come on, man.
That's part of being and meant to be. You have to be available at all times.
Yeah.
I want to share with you this little story. You know, or else I wouldn't forget anything. It says, you tell to those that are in need, keep your eyes open, watch, and you pray for divine appointments. Well, that's what I do. Okay, we have a little town out of Mariposa. Okay, but we were there. I noticed as I was driving from work or groceries or whatever it was, I noticed that there was a truck on the side of the road, a camper, and behind the camper was about 5 bicycles. Small ones, so I'm thinking, okay, where's it? Okay, the small bicycles, so there's got to be somebody that's small, the kids, that ride bicycles in it, they were on their way to Yosemite. So okay, I said, well, I need to go back. So we went home, dropped off the food. Wife said, yeah, go check and see. I said, okay, I'll go. So I went over there and I asked them for help if they needed anything. He said, well, our truck broke down. We were on our way to Yosemite. They're gonna pick up my truck. It's gonna take about a week to be able to get it fixed. So we don't know what to do. I said, well, why don't you, we'll call somebody up, get a truck that has a gooseneck, that's the one that's in the side of the federal truck, and we'll load it up and put it on, you know, my property. I have to wait to put it on the property, have an outlet where you can hook up electricity. And what was funny was the little girl said, you know what? I had just got to be praying for an angel to help us, to get me, that you sent me to help us. And she goes, and there's my angel. Maybe I, but it was nothing. It was just going to be available in the heaven, yeah. you could check up the neck up, you know.
Come on, now.
So, you have to just be available for him. Like I said, we are the hands and feet. Okay, just you want to hear, let's see. Right here, Galatians 6:10. I'll end it here. Galatians 6:10. As we have, therefore, as we have opportunities, let us be good and unto all men, especially to those that belong to the family of believers. Come on, be good to them extra. You know, be good to everybody, but mainly those in Galatians 6:10. Remember, Christian action is our grateful response to God's grace. If that is empowered by the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit, and it helps us to grow in likeness of Christ, then we involve ourselves in Christian action to generally live up to the image of God, that we have our eyes focused on Him and not what's around us. Christian action extends us to work. So your mission, if you choose to, that's the gift. That's the gift. Should be ministering the best to give the grace to someone that you know. Thank you for allowing me to share.
Amen.
Just remember, we are the hands and feet of Jesus. So I feel like we just have to be opposite. That's our responsibility. That's our job to you. You will feel for like sometimes. Thank you.
Amen.
I think we have a guest guitar player in here.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Come on
now. Rick and Carrie, come on up.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, Carrie.
Just kidding.
Well, it's a new song, and she hasn't really practiced it with me other than just playing the bass a little bit. But so you guys are first to hear the song. So bear with me. I haven't shared it with anybody until now. So. That's a fool. Tricked me out there. Yeah, see that? I just didn't see that. If it doesn't work, we'll find something else.
By no man was the fool.
So good. I haven't seen you guys in a long time. I'm like, ooh, it's always a divine appointment when they get here. I can't wait to see you afterwards. Hallelujah. Thank you. We don't get to worship with all these people, so it's so good to see you guys and have you guys here. And oh, it's good. Good. Love it. Amen.
God is good. God is good.
All the time.
I know nobody. Tell me who can give me this free.
Preacher in the house.
Yeah. All right, what a blessing to be at House of Prayer in Merced, huh?
Yeah.
You know what? Isn't it amazing that we're able to have a personal relationship with Jesus?
Yeah.
Stop and think about this. The Savior, everything was made through him. You look up at the sky, the stars, the planets, everything. Yet he cares about each and every one of us.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Yeah, God is awesome.
Yeah.
God is great.
Amen.
All the time. You know,
all the time.
God is good. Good.
Know it.
And God is great.
Amen.
Amen.
So, I want to share, I love going to the Word, because it's God's Word, right?
That's right.
That's right, yeah.
And if I'm a preacher, I should be sharing with you God's word.
Amen.
All right, so I'm going to go to Psalm 99 first. I'm going to go to a couple different places. But Psalm 99. The Lord our God is holy.
Yeah.
The Lord reigns. Let the peoples tremble. He sits enthroned on the cherubim. Let the earth quake. The Lord is great in Zion. He's exalted over people. Let them praise you. Great in awe. Awesome name. Holy is he.
Yahweh.
The king is in his mighty love. Justice. You have established equity. You have executed justice and righteousness in Jacob. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his footstool. He is holy. Moses and Aaron were among his priests. Samuel also was called among those who called upon his name.
Yes, thank you.
They called to the Lord and he answered them. Think about this for a minute. Moses, Aaron, Samuel, they called to the Lord and he answered him. But when you got a personal relationship with Jesus, we can call to the Lord and he's going to answer.
Amen.
And we got to be willing to trust when he gives us that answer.
Yeah, right. That's it.
His answer is going to be yes.
Amen.
It's going to be no. Or it's going to be not right now. But we're going to have to trust that he knows best. That his timing is perfect. That he's the holy God. And that he's not going to let us down. He's not going to let his children be forsaken.
Thank you, Lord.
We're able to have that relationship with him. Verse 7, in the pillar of cloud he spoke to them. They kept his testimonies and the statutes he gave them. O Lord, our God, you answered them and you were forgiving God to them. But an avenger of their wrongdoings. Exalt the Lord our God. Worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. God sees and hears people. He answers us. He forgives us. He blesses us.
Thank you, Lord.
But we must answer for our sins. That's why we need Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus paid for our sins.
Yeah.
Now that we are free, we have the freedom to sin, but that sin will come between you and God.
Come on.
Right.
And God won't bless your sin because you're not living your love for God. Let's look at 1 John 1, 5 through 10. It says, this is the message that we have heard from him and proclaimed to you, that God is light and in him is no darkness at all. If we say we have fellowship with him while we walk in darkness, we lie and we do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another. And the blood of Jesus, his son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. You know, it's sad because there's a trend going on in the world in the church today. There's a lot of people trying to say that certain types of sin are okay, that God accepts them, that you can go ahead and live this way, but that's not God's way. God wants you to be able to identify your sin. God wants you to be able to come to him and say, Lord, I am wrong. Please make me a new creation through you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your forgiveness. In 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, you know, when we read that word confess, it's not just speaking it, and it's definitely not speaking it in the box like some of the Catholics do.
Right.
But it's identifying that, hey, Lord, I realize that I have a problem.
Yeah.
Lord, and I can't do this on my own.
That's right.
I need your help.
Amen.
If we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Thank you, Lord.
If we say we have not sinned, and this is where that danger is coming in.
Mm-hmm.
People living in sexual sin, people living unmarried, or people living in the same type of sexual sins.
Yep.
Trying to say same sex can be a wedding. No. Not at all. It says, if we try to say it, that's all right with God. It says, if we say we've not sinned, we make him to be a liar, and his word is not in us.
Come on.
We got to be intentional about the truth. We got to be loving. We can tell these people, hey, look, God's not going to accept your sin, but Christ died for you. Come get to know him. Start a relationship with him.
Yeah.
He can help make changes in your life, and it starts with the Holy Spirit entering you.
Amen. Oh, yes. That's right.
I want to go one more place. Luke 9:23. And he said to them, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up your cross daily and follow me. That means that sometimes we got to tell our flesh no.
Yes, that's it.
We got to say, I can't do this because it's not what God would have me do.
Amen. Amen.
We got to tell our flesh no.
Yes.
And tell our God yes.
Amen.
Says, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it. Whoever loses his life for my sake will save it.
Amen. Right.
Lord.
For what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits himself? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words, of him the Son of Man will be ashamed of when he comes in his glory, the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. What I see is we're saved by grace.
That's right.
We're not saved by works. We've been forgiven on the cross of Calvary. If we've accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior, we're going to heaven.
That's right.
Come on now.
But we were saved to be a light for the Lord.
Yes.
The Bible says, Jesus said, if you love me, John 14:15, keep my commands. This was the upper room discord. He also said earlier on in the upper room discord in John chapter 13, he said, you can take all those commands. He wasn't saying keep the 613 commands of the old law that you're freed from.
Right.
He said, you can take all those commands and roll them into these two. Love the Lord God with all your heart, mind, body, soul, and strength.
Amen.
And love your neighbor as yourself.
Right.
We're to go out and tell people about the love of Jesus. To tell them, look, I may be a filthy sinner, I've been redeemed.
Yeah, well,
I'm just as guilty as you are, but I've been forgiven. And Christ died for you too. Now, if you don't know Christ, let me tell you, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world.
Amen.
Now think about this. God loved the world how much? So much that he put that love into action. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son.
Amen.
That's Jesus Christ.
Yep.
That whosoever believes in him, that includes you. Don't tell yourself it's too late. Don't tell yourself that you've already messed up.
Yeah.
Don't tell yourself you've been too bad. Because it's not based on what you've done. It's based on what Christ has done for you.
That's right.
Yeah.
That whosoever believes should not perish, but have an everlasting life.
Amen.
John 3:17. God's making it clear again.
Yes.
It says that God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. He didn't come here to kick us and tell us we're not good enough. And why is that? Because we all sin and we all fall short of God's glory. It says, but the world through him might be saved. And there's a big reason why I love the translations that say might. Because that's important.
Yep.
You have a choice to make.
Come on.
Are you willing to accept that Jesus died on the cross for your sins? That he rose again in 3 days?
That's right.
And that he's your only way to heaven. The only Son of God. If you're willing to accept that, you're going to heaven. You know, John 3:36 says, if you believe in the Son, that's Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
You should have everlasting life.
Amen.
But if you believe not,
right,
then God's wrath remains upon you.
Yep.
You might ask, what's God's wrath? The Bible says the wages of sin is death. Now, it's not the kind of death where you close your eyes and you don't exist anymore. It's not that death that atheists want you to believe.
Right.
Death is a spiritual death, an eternal separation from God.
Yeah.
It's hell, and it wasn't created for you. It was created for the devil and his demons.
Right.
Our God loves us so much that he provided a way for you so you don't have to go. And all you got to do is put your trust in him.
Yeah.
Be willing to start that relationship with him.
Amen.
Come on.
All that rest, he's going to help you work out.
That's
you're going
right.
to have a heart that's willing to change. It's a repentance heart. I recommend that if you haven't started a relationship with Christ Jesus, you do it today.
Amen.
It makes an eternity of difference. You guys be blessed.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have God.
Oh, there's nothing better.
Hallelujah.
We have one last song that we wanted to sing, and we were hoping that anybody that needs prayer and any prayer warriors would come forward and each one reach one. You know, some of us came here with heavy burdens tonight, and we're hoping not to leave with those heavy burdens tonight. And some of us just came with just a willingness to go and be wherever God wants us to be, and somebody might need to be at that altar helping them pray. So we would just ask that those of you that would, and those of you that need something from the Lord, would reach out and get it.
Amen.
We do
have one more speaker.
Yeah. We got one more speaker, too.
Oh, okay. All right, well, let's do that. Let's don't forget what I said. I'm not going to say that.
I'd like to introduce you guys to this guy. You know, God's given him a gift, and his name is Bob Chapman from Rock Bottom. Come on up, Bob. While I'm up here real quick, I'd like to thank each and every one here that has spoke tonight, everyone in the worship team. Thank you, guys. Thank you, House of Prayer, for allowing us to put this on.
Yeah.
Worship. And one more thing. We needed to do this in opening, and I didn't. Let's pray for Israel.
Amen.
Yes. Father God, Lord, I ask that you touch and be with your people, Father God, Lord, that you be with Israel, Father God, Lord. I ask, Father God, that you surround them, Father God, Lord, that you be with them, Father God, that you give them peace, Father God, Lord. Just guide them, Father God. Bring peace to them here soon, Lord. Let your will and work be done. Yes, in Jesus' Lord. Mighty name I pray. Amen.
Yes.
Hello, church.
Hello.
God bless you.
I love you too.
Turn to somebody and say, God bless, love you. I can see the light in your eye.
God must love you.
See the light in your eye. Just so you know, I'm not a preacher. I don't have a title. I don't even know if I have a gift.
You're a Bob. You're a Bob.
But I got Jesus. I'm going to talk about
that's a good
light
right there.
Of the world. First scripture I'm going to read is out of the Amplified. And I wasn't going to start with this until, I guess, God told me to start with it. But it's out of the Amplified. It is Hebrews 1:3. The sun is the radiance and only expression of the glory of our awesome God, reflecting God's Shekinah glory, the light being brilliant light of the divine, and the exact representation and perfect imprint of his Father's essence, and upholding and maintaining, propelling all things, the entire physical, spiritual universe by his powerful word. Okay, the universe along to its predetermined goal when he himself and no other had by offering himself on the cross as a sacrifice for sin, accomplished purification from sins, and established our freedom from guilt. He sat down, revealing his completed work at the right hand of the majesty on high, revealing his divine authority. Shekinah glory is the visible manifestation of God on earth, whose presence is portrayed through the natural occurrence. The word Shekinah is a Hebrew name meaning dwelling, or the one who dwells, or he causes to dwell. God refers himself to light from the beginning to the end of the Bible. From Genesis all the way to Revelation, including in Exodus. Exodus 13:21-22. And the Lord went before them by day in a pillar of cloud to lead the way, by the night in a pillar of fire to give them light, as to say to go by day and night. He did not take away the pillar of the cloud by day or the pillar by fire by night. From before the people. When they left slavery, they were given a promise. And he stayed with them every step of the way.
Amen.
Through thick and thin, through sin, through obedience and disobedience.
Amen.
The grace was there. The presence was there. The fire was there. Moses, I didn't have that scripture, but in Exodus, he revealed himself as in fire and light. Moses come down and he radiated of him, of his presence.
Amen.
And then he shy away and he like hide his face when he didn't have the glory. Why didn't he have the glory? He wasn't in his will. Right? In Genesis, in the beginning was God. Before the beginning, before all, God.
Come on, amen.
What was the first thing that he created?
Heaven and the earth.
Light.
Then God said, let there be light. And he's not a feminine God either. Right? He said, well,
that's right. Let
there be light. It was good. No, he said, let there be light. Then there was light. In the same tone. I didn't have that scripture. I didn't write that down. In the same tone, in the same authority. Lazarus, come out.
Yeah.
You know?
Come on.
In that authority. We have that authority.
Have
God is light. And in him, there is no darkness.
That's right.
And God saw that the light was good.
Amen.
And God divided the light from the darkness.
Yeah, right.
So, in the beginning, it wasn't little gas or burp, and then here we are smooth. No. God. Sorry. By the way, my message wasn't even done. And this is kind of new to me. So what I do is he drops down the scriptures. I look them up. I put them on paper. And then I try to add the message to it. Well, all I got is scriptures. My bad. Forgive me.
Come on now.
But God declared it and it happened. God recreated. Remember the first verse? He recreated his very essence through creation.
Yeah.
And what I say is he recreated himself to dwell with us.
Amen.
If you're the last person on this earth, he created it for you.
Come on, boss. Yeah.
If you're the last person on this earth,
right,
he did it for you.
Right.
No matter how far you think you've gone, how bad it is, how bad it was, he did it for you.
That's right.
John 8:12. Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Jesus gives us light. He lives in us and passes us the baton to run the race. What race? Salvation. Sorry about the phone. I lost the spot. Jesus gives us light. He lives in us, passes us baton to run the race. In him, there is no darkness. When we walk outside of his will, we are not in the light. And we walk in darkness. Come Who's on. Ever been depressed? Who's ever felt sad?
Yeah, right.
Who's been ill?
Done that.
Yeah.
Who's been worried?
Yeah, I've done that.
That is darkness, people.
Yeah, right.
God is not in the worry.
Right.
Amen.
By his stripes, we were healed.
Right.
Lord.
Yes.
There is no anxiety with Christ.
Yes.
Right?
Amen.
Power and love and a soundness of mind.
Yes.
Is the light of the world. Is yes. Christ.
Amen.
Why do you think
unbelievers come to us. Because the light is in you. They'll come to you. You know I don't believe, but I know you believe. Did you pray for me?
Amen. Come on, that's right.
Come on, that's the light. That's the gift he's given us. It's him.
Yes.
He's our gift. John 1, 4, 9. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in darkness. And in the darkness did not comprehend it. He came and sat down with us, and we shunned him. We're just as guilty as the ones that were there. How many times have you heard it in your spirit? Hey, don't do that. I'm the only one? Okay. Verse 6. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. This man came for a witness to bear witness of the light that all through him might believe. He was not the light, but he was sent to bear witness of the light. That was true light, which gives light to every man coming into the world. Every man, woman, and child coming into the world. Amen. There's that if, right?
Yeah.
If we receive him.
Yeah.
Ephesians 5:8-9. For you were once in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light. For the fruit of the Spirit is all goodness, righteousness, and truth. That first verse I read, it was talking that the light shines physically and spiritually. So light is the Spirit. If we're walking in the light, we're walking in His Spirit. If we're walking in His Spirit, we're shining for those that are out there. We're supposed to be walking around like beacons in the middle of darkness.
Right.
Every time we walk into a room, the spiritual atmosphere changes. Every one of us. Because of the Spirit that's in us.
Yes.
Why can't we walk around like that? In the physical. Why aren't we world changers? Why aren't we laying hands on the sick? Why aren't they being healed in our shadows?
Right. Think about it.
Think about it. Homework. Why aren't they?
Amen.
Matthew 5:14-16. Talk about the light in Scripture. He's the light. He's the light. He's the light. Right?
Yeah.
No. Check this out. You are the light of the world.
You.
You're the light of the world.
Yes.
You're the light of the world.
Come on.
A city is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket. Every time I read that, I think, man, what a basket case. Why are you going to cover your light, man?
Amen.
You know, the older I got, the older I'm getting, the older I am, the more I appreciate light. Especially driving, right?
Whoa.
How about, like, in a home or room or a motel or something, you're not used to, you're staying at somebody else's house, right? In the middle of the night, you're like,
yeah, right?
I do that in my own house.
What are we reaching for? Comes with age, brother, I get it. But we need that physical light. Everything that's in the grocery store that's consumable is there because of the light. Think about it. Vegetables. Right? Corn, tomatoes. How about the food that we eat? I mean, that's just feed. How about the cows and the pigs? Oh, I'm sorry, we're at church. Yeah, eat pork. We can eat pork. But it's the light that gives life.
Yeah.
Right? Physically, we need it to see. You know what? spiritually, I made it to see him, man.
Yeah.
Where was I? Okay, basket cases. Sorry, that's me. Neither do we light a lamp to put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. All that we do, we should glorify our Father in heaven.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
On the freeway, maybe this is for me. On the freeway, I should always glorify the Father in heaven. So I know you say don't speed or get. Oh, that person. Love that person and it's yourself.
Lord have mercy.
Revelation refers to Jesus as a light and only light. Revelation 21, 23, and verse 25. The city had no need for the sun or the moon to shine in it. For the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is the light. Take this protection here.
We're talking about the light. We're in church here.
Yeah. The glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is the light. And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light. And the kings of the earth bring their glory and honor into it. 25. Its gates shall not be shut at all by day. There shall be no night there.
Amen. Yeah.
Hey, Lord.
They shall see his face and his name shall be on their foreheads. For there shall be no night there. They need no lamp, nor light, or the sun. For the Lord God gives them light. And they shall reign forever and ever.
Amen.
David refers to the Lord as light. Everybody knows David, right? Yeah. Man after God's own heart.
Yeah.
King David, right? Killed giants.
Yeah.
And he armed himself ahead of time for the rest of the family. Took them out too.
Yeah.
He was chased. They were trying to kill him. They were trying to murder him. When he did sin, what did he do? He repented and he relied on the Lord God. There was part of his story. It's like, Lord, I would rather receive my punishment from you than of man.
Right.
Right?
Right.
Sorry, I'm going up. I'll just fix my nose. Psalm 119:105. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. He trusted him his entire life, even when he backslid.
Yeah.
Had lots of more. But he did trust. Because he repented. As soon as he get caught, you know, he's like me. You're busted. Okay, I'm sorry. But I repent. I'm not as fast as him. But his strength was his God.
Amen.
His path was directed by God.
Yeah.
Ours should be too. 27:1, Psalms 27:1, Psalm David. The Lord is the light and my what? Salvation.
Yeah.
Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my strength of my life.
Yes.
Light is life.
Yeah.
Of whom shall I be afraid? James 1:17. Every good and perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. So when we're going through those anxious moments, when we're sick, when we're going through worry, when the bank account, you're looking at the phone, it's like, oh my goodness, it's overdrawn again.
Right.
Don't worry. Budget better, but don't worry. That was me. But put all your trust in him.
Amen.
And he shall direct your path. He'll make a way where there is no way.
Right.
He'll also tell you, don't buy that.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So I get you to buy some flowers, but those are cheaper on the next door. Ephesians 6:12. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers. We're fighting the powers of the rulers.
Yeah.
Not just the White House, I'm just saying. Part of it. Come on. Against the rulers, against the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. I tell you, when we walk into a room, we shift that atmosphere. There's darkness waiting for you. They might back up at first, but they're waiting. They're waiting. See what you're looking at? See what you're saying?
Right. Come on.
And they're watching you shake.
Yeah. Right.
Because they're trembling at the same time.
Yeah.
Talking about the armor. Sleep with that armor on, man. They're waiting for you to take the helmet off. Yeah. Waiting to loosen your belt. Leave that armor on at all times. Amplified 6:12. Ephesians 6:12. But the struggle is not against flesh and blood, contending only with physical opponents. Remember, the light is physical and spiritual. Our war is spiritual. Physical opponents. But against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly supernatural places.
Come on.
They're making laws that are contrary to the word of God. There's politicians, and I'm not saying any names, I'm not even saying the country, that oppose Israel. Do it, man. That's God's country, not Texas. Texas isn't God's country, it's Israel.
Come on. Come on now.
Sorry, not trying to hurt anybody's feelings. It's not the left coast, but however, he is no respecter of person.
Come on.
Whether it's this coast, the other country, but his eye is on Israel. Why do you think? Every country in the world practically wants to stomp them out. Why are there countries saying death to Israel, death to the United States? I'm going off my message of politics. It's darkness trying to kill the light.
Right.
So I say, let your light shine. Stand up to the darkness.
Yeah.
That's
right.
How do we nourish that light spiritually? Prayer, read the word, team up with prayer warriors, warriors. It's the only way. Proverbs, this is my last one. Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge him and he shall direct your path.
Amen.
So, when you're not sure which way to go, you're not sure about that next purchase, you're not sure to take that job, leave that job, stay at that job. Shine some light on it. If you're not feeling well, feeling anxious, you're full of worry, turn the light on. Thank you all. Let that light shine.
Yeah. Oh,
try. You want to be the Savior, the world, the world, to the
I bless the church. Yep.